I did get arrested here for drug trafficking, but
I was never a drug dealer, except that one time I got caught with 50,000 pounds.
You know,
coke.
It's so crazy hanging out with you guys and just doing the stuff we do now. We have such a nice life. And then I look back at the stuff that I was doing. Who the fuck did I think I was down here by myself? I moved here at 18, 19, and I think the problem was I was really influenced by movies, so I thought that I was Boston George. Like, oh, yeah, whatever. I'll just go down there. I'll figure it out. You got some cocaine. I'll figure it out.
Sure. Was your life like living in the movies? Was it similar? Like, was it – where were you not? I was driving by, and there's a bunch of – and when you go into Miami, there's just a bunch of tall standing apartment buildings.
Yeah.
And that's – and all I can think about is the top floors of all those apartment buildings – have to be drug dealers or like big kingpins. Is that true or am I exaggerating?
A lot of this was built up off the cocaine business.
Yeah.
A lot of it was. I don't think it is anymore because I think the cocaine, they cracked down here so that it doesn't come in this way anymore.
That's why you moved to LA?
No. I moved to LA to do vines with you, David.
But sure.
Yeah, I do feel like I was in a movie. I still feel like I'm in a movie. This might sound a little selfish, but I feel like you're all just characters in my movie. But I feel like everybody's like that. Like Jason's got.
That's how David feels about all of us too.
I think that's how the majority of people feel.
Would you say you two are the two biggest narcissists in the group?
No, I am the biggest narcissist.
Well, we also have Jonah here. Jonah, do you feel like we're all in your movie, or do you just feel like you're an extra in our movie and that's your life purpose?
Well, to be honest, for me, when I'm like going about my day, I like turn everything into a scene. So when the cameras aren't rolling, I look at it from like a third person perspective, like the camera's looking at me, but the camera's not. And it's always a bit. I don't know why. It's weird.
Dude, that movie sucks.
Okay, no, back to the whole thing. Okay, so you moved out here. You were telling me earlier that you graduated from.
Well,
like,
let me be honest. I'll tell you the real story.
Please,
don't hold back. No exaggeration for the fucking vlogs or whatever character stuff. I moved out here because I had a job cutting hair in a barbershop that was opening up, and it was going to be a lot of like celebrities and athletes and 18-year-old me from Staten Island. I was like, oh, this sounds like a dream come true. I get to cut celebrities' hair. I'll be living in like paradise because it looks beautiful here.
Yeah, it's gorgeous.
So that's what I originally came down here for. And then I realized I just have the same salary that I had back in Staten Island, and now I have to hang out and live this lifestyle with all of these, you know.
You weren't keeping up with the celebrities.
Just everybody here in this town are just fast money.
It's a lot more expensive.
Yeah.
Just living.
Yeah. Like when you used to sell the waters at Runyon.
Oh, yeah.
On the hiking trail. When you moved to LA, you would sell.
I don't know if I told the story on the podcast, did I? There's like this run. There's a Runyon Canyon is huge in Hollywood. It's like this big, it's a big canyon where people go hiking. And at the bottom of it, there's this guy who has a stand. And it's donations only, and you can buy water, you can buy soda, you can buy snacks after your hike.
So you ripped off his business.
And he has a donation box, like at the bottom. He's like, please be honest, it's the honor system. So you take something and you give him a dollar for the Coke or whatever. And everyone uses it because they're so tired after the hike and there's no water fountains. That's the only way to really get a snack after the hike. And recently I found out he makes, how much does he make, like a month?
I heard that he makes $15,000 a week.
A week?
Shut up.
This is what I heard. It could be just gossip.
No, I think you meant a month.
Okay.
I think it's 15 a month, which is still fucking crazy.
Still insane from selling waters.
Yeah. 15,000 a month. And he does that. He lives right next to the little stand he has, and there's no one even working it. It's just the water's just sitting there. He refills it in the morning and then he leaves. So I thought, I love this business idea, but he's already got it going. So my friend and I...
You hired two of the smartest guys you know, Dom and Alex, right?
No, it was my friend Mason. Dom didn't want to do it, but it was my first roommate, Mason. We went to Target, we bought a bunch of water bottles, we bought coolers, we bought ice, and then in the morning at 4 a.m., before people even were on the hiking trail, we took all the coolers up to the top of the trail. So it took us about 45 minutes, and we did two trips of taking all these coolers to the top. Because I'm like, well, if this guy's making so much money at the bottom of the hill, imagine how thirsty people are at the top of the hill.
Okay.
So I brought all the waters up to the top of the hill, and I put a donation box that said, be honest, This is, you know, this is, it's on the honor system. I copied exactly what the guy was doing.
So
at
you
the
weren't worried about stepping on anybody's toes. You're on this guy's territory now. This is his stomping ground.
No, I wasn't worried about it because I considered it like Uber versus Lyft. You know what I mean? Like I was just another player in the game, but it wasn't, we couldn't keep it up because the plan was insane because we had to get up at 4 a.m. and carry these huge coolers. And if you know Runyon, it's not an easy hike. Especially when you're carrying like ginormous coolers. So we made like, I think we made like $200-$300 the first couple days, but it wasn't worth it because we were just fucking, we'd go there 4 a.m.
Too much overhead.
Yeah, we'd get back at 6:30 in the morning and we'd be passed out the rest of the day because, yeah.
But well, dude, you took a risk. It didn't work out this time, but I know that we're both big believers in everything happens for a reason, right?
Yeah.
And then that got you to doing what you're doing now.
Making YouTube videos.
Yeah.
So you're a barber, and then you're like, I need to start drug dealing.
No, I move out here. I'm working in the barber shop. I'm doing pretty well. I'm successful for a barber salary, whatever.
Sure.
One day, Amber Rose walks in, and I'm like, holy shit, you look like Kanye West's ex-girlfriend. At the time, they were dating. And she's like, oh, sweetie, I am Kanye's girlfriend. Can you give me a haircut? And I'm like, holy shit. Like, I was fucking starstruck. All these celebrities are coming into this barbershop. I'm 18, 19 years old. I'm introduced to this whole new lifestyle, and I have no money,
yeah.
Basically. You know what that's like, Jason.
Have no money? Yeah. It's been my whole life,
except
for
Jason
sure.
Jason didn't turn to drugs because he is an intelligent man who worked his way to the top.
Oh, my God. Thank you, David. I'm the kidding. Rare compliment.
I'm kidding.
Oh, okay. Got it. The funniest thing Jeff ever said to me, I got it all out of Jeff once, like off camera, off mic. When we went to New York, we had a dinner,
yeah.
And he told me everything. And it was really interesting. And the most interesting thing he said is I kept saying to him, I go, didn't it bother you that like you were going to get caught? Like, you have all this money. Wouldn't that bother you, David? Like, fuck, I'm going to get caught. I know I'm going to get
caught.
That's
so fucking scary.
Right? And he said he actually, what he loved was like the thrill of it, like the chase of it.
Sure.
And that's what kept him going.
Yeah.
Well, when I was successful.
Once you met Amber Rose, this is when you were like, oh shit, Amber Rose is living this life and I want to kind of live this life. So you wanted to elevate your lifestyle and you're like, I need to get into drugs.
I feel like such a pussy saying it with her name specifically. It was a lot more.
But yes,
it was. That was part of it.
And then you went to your friends that you already knew through like connections and you went, hey, give me a bag of coke. I'm going to flip this bitch and I'm going to make some money. How did that work?
I started going back to a lot of my New York friends. They started trickling down here. This is like, they call this like the sixth borough, Miami Beach. Mm. So this is like where people that kind of want to get out of New York, they come down here and that crime kind of overflowed down to here. And then I'm meeting these people and just putting two and two together. Like, how'd you get into Vine? One of your friends told you, like, hey, try this out. And then you saw that there's money.
I love these comparisons to being an international drug dealer to being a Viner.
It's the same shit, dude.
Sure.
You get introduced to something. Your friends are doing it. You see that they're dumb and they're successful at it. Oh, this idiot could do this. I could do this too.
Yeah.
And I could do it better probably.
100%. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. And then you also got busted in Miami.
Well, here's the thing. Cutting hair, you know everyone. You meet everybody in that town instantly. Like, word of mouth spreads quickly. And now I know everyone, so why not? It was just easy. It just kind of happened naturally.
100%. And then you got arrested again because cops came into your house and they found that you were running a small casino gambling thing inside your apartment.
Okay, so a couple of my buddies back in New York, they had this poker game that was doing really well and they wanted to try it out down here. So I liked the idea and I hosted it. I hosted it maybe for like 2 months and then somebody that was playing in the game got in trouble and they snitched on the game and then cops came in, illegal search and seizure. Everything they did was against the law, but Miami Beach cops, you know, they're used to taking down fucking cocaine kingpins. So they don't listen. They don't follow the rules. They just want to bust the bad guys, which makes sense. It's cool, whatever. They got me and I wasn't trafficking bricks of cocaine. I wasn't doing like what it looks like, what I got busted for.
Yeah.
I was really just having a friendly card game with friends, and I was taking a little percentage, a little rake.
Card game with friends. It literally sounds like you're talking to a cop right now. Officer, just a friendly card game.
There's probably some cops in here.
And this is prop cocaine. It is not real. We're just painting the illusion. We've seen too many movies.
But when I did get taken out of my house because what I was doing was illegal. You can't have casinos in your apartment.
Yeah.
So
they can't bust you for that if it's an illegal search.
So that's what I'm saying. What they did was illegal. They broke the law when they arrested me, but that's why they didn't file charges because it was an illegal search. I had a lawyer. They fought it, and I was released.
If it was a legal search and they caught you with
that, I would have been in jail for a long time.
How long?
Probably, I don't know, 5 years.
Fuck that.
Yeah. So,
and what's jail like?
Out here, it was not bad. It was nice. There was palm trees and stuff. It was really beautiful.
Maybe I'll stop by. Yeah.
When they did take me out, I lived in like a nice like luxury apartment building, and they took all my poker chips. So these poker chips were in white boxes, and they had clear evidence bags. So as they're bringing me out, they're taking me past all my valet, my security in the building, and it just looks like they were busting like a major kingpin, like cocaine dealer. And it was all fucking chips in the bags. So when I went back, when I finally got out like 3 months later, they just looked at me like, how the fuck did this guy get busted with like 50 kilos of cocaine? And now he's just going back to his apartment. But my cocaine charges were, it was like a little baggie that they had that one of the people playing in the games had to keep them going. Because
they couldn't find the rest in the walls.
Yeah, exactly. Are you allowed to talk
about this? They didn't check under the mattress.
I'm allowed to talk about it. I didn't do it.